You are here today for Who's Who in the Oaks, and this is almost 300 people on this event, so thank you so much for attending. This event will be presented by Kate Marianchild. It is the 9th in the Center for Environmental Inquiry at Sonoma State University's Fall Dig Into Nature Series of 2020 virtual events. So my name is Carrie Winninger, and I am the outreach lead for the center. And we're presenting this event today in partnership with the Anderson Valley Land Trust, devoted to helping landowners in Mendocino County's Anderson Valley conserve their land so their property can be protected, managed, and used to preserve its conservation values. Until COVID-19 hit us, our public events were held either at our Osborne Preserve on Sonoma Mountain in Pengrove, or at our Galbreath Preserve near Yorkville in Mendocino. And while we miss having people on the preserves, this Zoom format has allowed us to really reach a larger and broader audience. So we're so happy you could all be here. So as I mentioned, for some of you that are just now entering, if you could please type your name and where you're from in the chat box of Zoom, that's going to be our sign-in sheet for the day. And it's also how we will make sure to get you post-event materials, which you don't want to miss. And please write your full name. For those of you who are new to Zoom, you can access this chat feature at the bottom of your screen. If you don't actually see the word chat, it could be under three dots that can be expanded. Another thing helpful to know about Zoom today is at the top right corner of your screen, you might see something that says view. And that's where you can choose screen view options. And for today's event, we recommend you choose speaker view. Before I let Kate take it away, I want to tell you a little about what the Center for Environmental Inquiry is and how we can be a resource to you, no matter if you're affiliated with SSU or not, whether you're a student, a parent, a government employee, an educator, a member of the public, or maybe you work with an organization that's in need of environmental solutions. The Center for Environmental Inquiry envisions a North Bay working together to find sustainable solutions. And we invite you to get environmentally ready with us. The way we're doing this is we're building a community of learners and problem solvers across all sectors of society, not just the traditional sectors you might think of for environmental fields, by providing enhanced understanding of our connection with the environment and skill building experiences that lead towards sustainable solutions. There are many ways to get involved. You can engage in our research programs, come as an independent researcher, do one of our trainings. So we have naturalist training, land management.
No, honey, thank you very much.
If anyone who's entering could please mute yourself and stop your video, that would be really helpful. Thank you. And we also have ways to partner on projects or events like these. So the whole point is that each one of you is critical in addressing the greatest environmental challenges in history. So thank you for being a part of it. Today, we're going to talk about oak trees, focusing on those in Northern California. Kate will tell you more about why these species are so important. It looks like I was muted there for a minute, so I'm going to repeat part of that. Wanted to make sure you knew that we're talking about oak trees today, focusing on those in Northern California. So Kate will tell you much more about why these species are important, but what I wanted to say is just how quintessential California trees are, these oaks are in California, and how they support a major portion of biodiversity. Kate Marianchild has led several events for the Center for Environmental Inquiry over the past few years, being extremely generous in sharing her love for and deep knowledge of our oak woodlands. Kate's a naturalist living in the Ukiah area and author of the best-selling Secrets of the Oak Woodlands, Plants and Animals Among California Oaks. This is a must-have for anyone who enjoys being out in nature, if you haven't already read it. Today, Kate will present for about 40 minutes, during which time she'll help us all identify the species of oaks that produce the acorns that we hopefully all brought. And then we'll have time for some Q&A at the end, during which we hope to address many of your questions. So another couple Zoom things. I have muted you all and turned off your video, but if that's not working, I ask that you double check that you are muted and your video is turned off. And both of those buttons can be found in the lower left-hand corner of your screen. If you do have any issues or questions that come up, go ahead and put them in the chat box. And there are a lot of you, but I will try to be monitoring that chat box throughout the event. And it can be for anything technical, like you can't hear Kate. And it can also be any questions that come up you want to be asked at the end of the event. Because of the size of the event, I'm actually going to be taking the questions from the chat and I will ask them out loud to Kate at the end. So feel free and type those in early and I'll compile a list and try and get those going. And I do apologize in advance. We probably won't get to everybody's questions, but we are able to stay on late. So after our formal 12 o'clock stop, Kate can still stay with us for another 15 minutes or so if you'd like to stay more to ask questions. And do feel free also to email me. I'm going to put my email in the chat right now, winingek at sonoma.edu. And that is anything that you are concerned or have questions about this event or anything in the future. So please know that this event is being recorded and it'll be posted on our website. And it will be at cei.sonoma.edu/calendar/past. And that'll be up within about a week. And we will let you know when that happens. You can also look at all of our other past events on the past events page. So we'll be sending you a web address for resources relevant to Kate's talk after the event, including her page on restoring butterflies and birds, complete with a donate button, and pages for ordering her oak guide, her book, and the close focus binoculars she sells. So if you don't already receive occasional emails from Kate with her photo essays and event announcements, just please let us know if you do not want to be added to that mailing list. It's really a good thing to be aware of. All that being said, I am going to start focusing on the chat and let Kate take it away from here.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. Well, hello, everybody. This is the first Zoom talk I've given, and I had absolutely no idea that so many people would show up. And I've looked at the registration list, and I've seen names of many people I've met on my speaking trips, as well as old friends, and it's just been a wonderful antidote to the isolation of COVID. So welcome to those of you that I know and to all of those I haven't yet met. I have no doubt that we're all kindred spirits in our love for nature. COVID has actually been good for me because it gave me a chance to slow down and observe nature in a way that I haven't done since before I started writing my book in 2010. And I was resistant to pulling myself away from my wonderful nature and working on a PowerPoint for a Zoom talk. But when Margot Rollins approached me, I said yes immediately. I'd gotten over my fear of the technology learning curve, and I just love working with Margot, who is with us today. And this is about our fifth project together. Plus, I treasure everyone I know in Center for Environmental Inquiry and in Anderson Valley Land Trust. And I have great appreciation for what both organizations are doing. And just one item of housekeeping. If you decide just to go straight to my website to order the guide without waiting for us to send out the website addresses and everything, because we are going to do that, you can't find, my oak guide isn't accessible on the homepage, nor is my butterfly and moth and caterpillar page. You have to go to any other page besides the homepage, and then you can find a menu on the left. So we have a whole lot to cover today, and let's get started. Today I'm going to give you tips for identifying the tree oaks of Northern California, and I'm also going to sprinkle my talk with some little known oak lore. Oaks need friends and advocates now more than ever, and recognition is the first step in friendship. So why are oaks important? Because they provide food and shelter for more wildlife, including not just wildlife abundance, but wildlife species, than any other terrestrial ecosystem in California. That's partly because their energy-rich acorns feed animals from insects and rodents to birds and bears. But it's also partly because more than any other plant in North America, oaks support enormous numbers of juicy, nutrient-rich caterpillars. This funny-looking caterpillar in the upper left is the larva of the California sister butterfly, who lays her eggs only on oaks. And she especially likes canyon live oak, which is the tree in the background. Caterpillars eat leaves voraciously, and then most of them get eaten in turn. Most of the caterpillars get eaten in turn, and thus become the foundation of multiple food webs. And I bet you didn't know that caterpillars turn into birds. I say that because caterpillars are the primary food for most baby songbirds. So this robin was raised mainly on caterpillars, and now she's collecting caterpillars to feed her own babies. Without caterpillars, in fact, the spring bird song that we enjoy so much every year would be greatly muted. So when I was writing my book, I didn't know much about individual oak species. I was primarily fascinated with the plants and animals and lichens and fungi that live among the oaks. But after the book came out in 2014, everybody assumed that I was an expert on oaks themselves, how to identify them, how to plant them, how to cage their seedlings. So I have now learned a lot about planting oaks from Lindsay Daly, and with the help of Carrie Heise and Pralata Papper, I've created an oak identification guide for the common oaks of Northern and Central California. This is a two-sided laminated guide that shows what I call classic acorns and leaves. And here in the bottom row, there are galls that occur only on individual species of oaks in the white oak section. And you can tell here that this side of this guide is about the white oak section. This is the other side of the guide, and up here it says that this is the red and golden oak sections, and I'm going to talk about what sections are later. So if you have trouble identifying oaks, you are in exalted company. That's because oaks sleep around a lot with other oak species. In other words, they hybridize, and that changes how they look. So they often look like a little of one and a little of the other, or a little of one and a lot of the other. And sometimes you just have to smile and shrug and say, hell if I know. But I'm going to give you clues that are reliable if you see them on a tree, but not particularly if you don't. So a lot of people have a hard time remembering the characteristics that help with oak identification. So I'm going to try out some mnemonic aids on you today, including some poems that you'll recite with me at the end. And all this is partly because this workshop is in a series put on by CEI that is supposed to be about interaction between a naturalist and learners. So, the oak genus Quercus first appears in the fossil record about 45 million years ago. And in the beginning, oaks were pollinated by wind, but then for some unknown reason, they decided to try insects. But that apparently didn't work out so well, because then they went back to wind, possibly because there aren't very many insects around when oaks bloom, which is early in the spring. There are about 600 oak species in the world. This one is in England. And North America is the center of oak diversity, thanks primarily to Mexico, which has a whopping 160 oak species, many of them endemic. Then the U.S. has 90, and China is right up there with 100 species. And all but a few of the world's oaks are in the Northern Hemisphere. A few trickle down into Indonesia, but all the rest are in the Northern Hemisphere. So of the 90 that are in the United States, California has 22 species, which is a pretty respectable number, and almost all of them have been planted by this bird, the California scrub jay, which has co-evolved with oaks. Its bill is specially designed for tugging on acorns and carrying them. And it is a predator of the seeds of oaks. It eats acorns, but it also plants the next generation of oaks. Each bird stores up to 50,000 acorns in the ground each fall in what are often the absolutely ideal spots for germination. And they leave up to about a third of them there uneaten. And right this very minute, they are replanting burned lands. But jays rely on oaks for something else, caterpillars. Like robins, they primarily feed caterpillars to their babies, who would then grow up to be planters of oaks. So to me, this is just a beautiful symbiosis between a tree genus and a bird species. Now, I know that some of you don't know an oak from a buckeye, from a maple, from a sycamore. So it should help you to know that oaks are the only trees in North America that produce nuts that are snugged into hard cups or caps. You can call them either. The official name is cupules. So these are all acorns and caps that I collected in the last week here in Mendocino County, and they represent 8 species. The ones on the left come from the true oaks and are in the genus Quercus, and on the right are the acorns of tan oaks, which are in the genus Notholithocarpus. So take a good look at those tan oak acorns, because we won't see them again in this slideshow. And now look at the acorns that you brought with you. And make sure you have a pen and a piece of paper available. Do you have any acorns with bristly caps? If so, write tan oak on a piece of paper and set your acorn on it. These are the only acorns with bristly caps, at least in California. And a way to remember that is that tan oaks bristle with indignation about not being considered true oaks. It's one of those DNA things, you know, but tan oaks are extremely important. A lot of wildlife depend on them, because their acorn crops are more reliable than the crops of any of the other oaks. And that might be because, unlike oaks in the genus Quercus, tan oak flowers are pollinated by insects as well as wind. Their acorns are also one of the two favorite acorns of the Pomo people in whose homeland I live. The other one is black oak. So now, please pick up another one of the acorns you brought with you and close your eyes. If the cap is not connected to the acorn, just hold the cap. You don't need to hold the nut. And if you have more than one acorn, this is a good time to make sure that you're keeping track of which acorn goes with which cap. So roll that cap around in your fingers, feeling its texture on the outside. See if it has any scales that you can get a fingernail under. And be careful, you don't want to get something jammed under your fingernail. Or feel for hard fused bumps or warts with tiny low spots between them. Or notice if it's kind of soft and velvety. What we're trying to do is figure out whether your acorn is from a tree in the white oak group or section, the red section, or the golden oak section. So a section is just above a species and just below a subgenus. It's a taxonomic category. And the reason we're focusing on acorns is that they're part of the reproductive apparatus of the tree, and the reproductive parts are the most genetically stable, the slowest to change when species hybridize. I made up a little jingle about that. Leaves change all over the map while nuts and caps are taking a nap. So sections are important because oaks sleep around only with other oaks that are in the same section. So if you haven't yet, now open your eyes and see if your cap looks like any of these. These caps have modified scales that are called tubercles, or it's easier to think of them as warts or bumps, and they are typical of oaks in the white oak section. So if your acorn cap looks like one of these, jot down the term white oak section on a piece of paper and set your acorn and cap on it, or multiple acorns if you have them. And I'll wait just a sec. I know it takes a minute to write that. Okay, so if the cup of your acorn looks like one of these, it's in the red oak section. And these are the ones that you might have been able to get a fingernail under, although you can't always. So these caps have scales that overlap each other, somewhat like papery roofing shingles. And the lower edge of the cap is often slightly fringy looking. So if you have one or more of these, write red oak section on a piece of paper and set your acorn and cap on it. And while you're doing that, I'm going to take a drink. Okay, so now we're going to review with some mnemonic aids. For the white oaks, W is for white oaks, and whites have warts. So I'm going to say that again, and why don't you say it with me? And I learned from a speech therapist that if you add emotion to something that you say, you're more likely to remember it. So you could put some attitude in here if you want, like whites have warts, or whites have warts? So, whites have warts. I mean, W is for white oaks, and whites have warts.
Sound cut out, Kate. I can't hear you.
Can anyone else not hear me?
I can hear you fine.
I'm good. Yeah.
I can hear you. Duck can hear you.
I can hear you fine.
Okay.
Anyone who's having trouble, you can private chat me and I'll try and help.
Okay. Another clue to white oaks is these oak apple galls, which occur only on oaks in the white oak section. The gall on the left is one, this is from the spring, and because they're green, sometimes really small and green in the spring. And this one, these two I took just about a week ago, so they turn brown by now. Galls are produced by trees at the bidding of tiny harmless wasps the size of fruit flies. And these wasps lay eggs only on trees of one section. So now I'm going to throw down a gauntlet for you. If wasps the size of tiny fruit flies can tell what section an oak is in, so can you. There are many more gall species that occur on oaks, especially in the white oak section, and many of them are those colorful ones that I showed you briefly on my guide. But these are the ones that are the biggest and easiest to see. So I, for instance, was leading a walk and we were eating lunch in the middle of the day, and we were looking across at a tree, and I very confidently identified it as an interior live oak, I think. And then someone in the class smarter than me said, "But look, it has those galls on it." And I realized, oh, that can't be an interior live oak. That's in the wrong section. It has to, and it was actually a scrub oak. and California scrub oak. So now we're going to move on to a mnemonic aid for the red oak section. R is for red oaks because reds are roofed with shingles. Those overlapping scales are like shingles. And they can also be kind of rough and scratchy. So we can also have another R word in there for the mnemonic aid. So why don't you say that one with me too? R is for red oaks, and reds are roofed with shingles. And now let's see if you have an acorn in your collection there, like one of these from Canyon Live Oak. This is the only tree oak in Northern California that's in the golden oak section, as opposed to a scrub oak. And I'm not going to give you tips for identifying the golden oak section because that's kind of tricky. I'm just going to help you identify Canyon Live Oak itself. A lot of people aren't even aware of this tree's existence, so I'm going to spend a little extra time on it. When my friend Kyle took me to see an ancient canyon live oak. Whoops, I think I missed something. Near Garberville, I just burst into tears when I saw it. It was so enormous and so clearly ancient. So when acorns of canyon live oaks have matured, their cups are often wide with thick walls, like most of the ones in this photo. See how thick these walls are, and see how wide that that cap is, and this one is wide, and they're all wide and thick, and they often have a cork-like quality with a little bit of give and a soft velvety surface. And that the velvety surface is a result of a fine gold down that covers them. Or they can be wide and woolly, like this one. I've seen one of these. It was up in Yosemite. But these acorns mature in their second year. So if you're looking at one of this year's acorns, like these, I took this picture about a week ago. The thick cap might not be very obvious yet. It's obviously not very wide. But you can remove the cap and look at the underside, and then you can see how it's beginning to thicken here and also kind of curving in a little bit, as opposed to this, which is from an acorn in the white oak section. And it's a good trick to know that you can look at the cap because they might not actually get wider or thicker. So if you have an acorn that looks like any you've just seen, write Canyon Live Oak on a piece of paper. But I usually, I'll wait a minute while you do that and I'll take another drink. Okay, but I usually first recognize a canyon live oak by its leaves, which are quite distinctive because they are quite leathery and flat, often very flat, and often narrow and pointed at the end. These don't narrow as quickly, but I see more of this around here anyway. But I've been faked out by leaves of interior live oak before, thinking it was canyon live oak. So the next best thing is to turn the leaf over and look and see if you see a fine gold patina, which is the same kind of fuzz that's on the outside of the acorn caps. So you'll have to turn over a bunch of leaves, especially younger leaves, because the gold disappears with age. Here's an image. Huh. of the leaves and the acorns together. And see how these acorns, they're still green, but they're bigger than those other ones that I took a picture of a week ago, and the caps are wider and maybe and thicker, definitely thicker too. Now look at the edges or margins of these leaves versus those other leaves. These are also from Canyon Live Oak. And the color, I don't know why they're so blue looking. It might have been just a matter of light. So why do these leaves have those spines on them while these do not? And you know, I was hoping someone would ask that question because it brings up some really cool oak lore. Deer and elk and caterpillars and wood rats all love to eat oak leaves. So oaks have evolved coping strategies. When deer browse a certain percentage of the leaves of a tree, and of course that's always low down, the tree secretes a hormone that causes the lower parts of the tree to grow, of the leaves in the lower parts of the tree to grow these spine tips. And that's why you'll often see spine tip leaves in the upper part of, in the lower part of a tree, but smoothed edge leaves higher up. And the same phenomenon happens with coast live oak and interior live oak and shrieve oak. It's not just canyon live oak, and even sometimes with blue oaks, which is in the white oak section. But the tree has a different strategy when caterpillars eat its leaves. Instead of discouraging the caterpillars by secreting toxic chemicals, which I'm sure the trees could do, the tree actually seems to me encourages the caterpillar. It at the base of every leaf, there is a second set of leaf buds just lying in wait in case they're needed. And when the tree loses a certain percentage of its leaves to caterpillars, it secretes a hormone that causes that second set of leaves to flush. And if too many of those leaves get eaten, there is a third set of leaf buds waiting in the wings. And if this is a true case of co-evolution, I'm not sure, but it could be. It may be that caterpillars benefit oaks by fertilizing them with their copious poop, that sometimes there's so much of it, it sounds like it's raining, and their dead bodies, of course, fall to the ground and decompose. And the caterpillars also attract lots and lots of birds and other insects, and they also probably add compost to the soil. And then, of course, the caterpillars become food for baby birds that grow up to plant new oaks. So instead of worrying about leaf damage like that we see over here on the left, we should be celebrating it. And in fact, in these days of plummeting insect populations, we should be saying, woo-hoo, look at that leaf damage. This tree has caterpillars. That means we'll have butterflies and birdsong next spring. And that means that we have to start gardening for caterpillars, which means planting native plants, because most caterpillars have had to evolve resistance to the toxins that plants protect themselves with. And that means they have to have, the caterpillars have to have been around in the same places the plants have for a long time. And it's only native plants that fit that bill. So we have to plant native plants. And because there are about 20 times more moths than butterflies, we have to think of ourselves as gardening for moths, not for butterflies or for birds. I mean, we can do that too, but we have to include moths. Okay, back to identifying. Oh, sometimes it doesn't advance. Back to identifying oaks. So Now we're back on the red oak side, and this is the red oak section, these first three columns, where we have black oak, interior live oak, and coast live oak. And by the way, a lot of people don't realize this, but live means evergreen. When you hear of a live oak, it means it's an evergreen oak. It keeps its leaves all year round. And from now on in the talk, I will be identifying oaks by species, not section. And my goal is to get to the white oak species, but I'm just going to give you a couple of assists with some species of the red oaks. So black oak, which confusingly is in the red oak section, is the only California oak that has long, fine, and somewhat flexible things called bristle tips at the ends of its lobes. And here you can see them magnified against a black background. And they are a 100% reliable clue as long as you are in the oak genus. Make sure you're not looking at a maple, because I've seen these things on maples and there are other species that have them. So to help remember this, please say with me, black oaks have bristle tips. And you could try saying it really fast to yourself if you want. It's a little bit of a tongue twister. So the acorns of black oaks are pretty unmistakable. They're large with cups that extend halfway or even more up the nut, sometimes maybe a little bit less. And of course, they have overlapping scales in the roofing shingle style of all red oaks. And I guess that's all I'm gonna say about them for now. They're pretty hard to confuse with anything else. And now I'll give you a couple of tips for identifying coast live oak, which is also in the red oak section. Mature coast live oaks often have these beautifully curvy, sinuous, sometimes twisty trunks and limbs. If you've ever been in a coast live oak woodland, it can be really magical. Of course, they've been hammered with sudden oak death, so there aren't as many of those around anymore. And here is a tip for the truly dedicated learner of oak identification tips. Many of the leaves on coast live oaks have what we call hairy armpits on the underside, like this. So I bet your eye went right here. But no, that's not where these hairy armpits are. They're right here and right here. And this is highly magnified, so they're very inconspicuous. So now I want you to fold your arms and put both hands in your own armpits and give yourself a nice hug and a big squeeze. And I'll take a hug too from all of you to me, and I'm giving one to all of you. And while you're hugging yourself, say with me, it's on the screen, coast live oaks are just like me, with hairy armpits, hard to see. And say that again. Coast live oaks are just like me, with hairy armpits, hard to see. When you're looking for hairy armpits, you may have to turn over 10 or even 20 leaves to find one, because a lot of the leaves don't have them. And close focus binoculars are very helpful, though you can often at least see the fuzz with the naked eye. I imagine it can be there and you can't even see it, but I don't know about that. They're always at the intersection of the mid vein, which is right here, and one of the lateral veins. And just remember that you have to look really, really closely. And another clue for coast live oak that I just learned yesterday from Carrie Heisey is that there on coast live oaks, there are always fewer than 6 lateral veins on each side. And that is unique among the red oaks. Now I'm going to turn over the guide and we'll look at the white oak section. We have here on the left, 3 deciduous white oaks, Valley Oak, Oregon Oak, also known as Gary Oak, and Blue Oak. And over here we have 1 evergreen white oak, which is California Scrub Oak, and I'm not going to be able to get to that today. I'm going to start with Quercus lobata, Valley Oak. Though Valley Oaks do grow in hills, they absolutely love floodplains or former floodplains. Like here where I live in Ukiah, they just pop up all over the place in every vacant lot. And floodplains are usually in valleys, hence the name Valley Oak. Valley Oaks used to grow in riparian corridors that were 5 miles wide on each side of the great rivers that flow out of the Sierra into the Central Valley. And in fact, it is said that in the past, you could walk the entire length of the Central Valley and never leave the shade of a Valley Oak. But Valley Oaks also grow on hills and ridges. And to be able to do that, they have to send sinker roots as far as 80 feet down into standing water. So here is a Valley Oak acorn. The cup has large warts and the nut is seated pretty deeply in the cup. The nuts are very large. When mature, they're the longest in California, sometimes 3 times longer than they are wide. And if you turn the acorn over, it's roughly in the, you can see that it's roughly in the shape of a V. So V is for very long V-shaped Valley Oak acorn. Try saying that with me. Very long V-shaped Valley Oak acorn. And now for the leaf, which there isn't much confusion about Valley Oak acorns, but there is a lot of confusion about Valley Oak leaves because they look so much like Oregon Oak leaves to the untrained eye, and even to the trained eye when there is a lot of gene flow happening between species. So these protrusions, I like to call them hills, are called lobes, and these indentations are called sinuses, but I like to think of them as valleys since it's a Valley Oak. On classic Valley Oak leaves, the lobes, these parts are softly rounded like this rather than pointy, and at least some of the sinuses or valleys are deep and wide, and sometimes they, sometimes the sides of those valleys are perpendicular to the mid vein. That won't happen, that'll happen on only a few leaves. So, rounded lobes and occasional deep wide sinuses that are sometimes perpendicular to the mid vein rather than diagonal are diagnostic, pretty much. There are always exceptions. And most leaves on a given Valley Oak won't have these deep wide perpendicular sinuses or even just deep wide ones. But if you find even a few leaves that have them, your tree is probably a Valley Oak, and the acorn will probably settle the matter for sure. And if the inner edge of the sinus right here is parallel to the mid vein, that's also pretty classic. This is a leaf that, these are all leaves that I photographed last week. And this leaf has the straightest parallel edge of a sinus and parallel to the mid vein that I've ever seen. What is that? That whole sinus there is like a parallelogram. Never seen one like that. These leaves, and look how rounded, nicely rounded these lobes are. And this is a pretty deep sinus and pretty wide. And so is this one. Those qualify. But look at these young leaves. I collected those a week ago. And one of the signature characteristics of valley oaks is that they keep producing small new leaves all summer. I think that's unique to valley oak.
Hi, Kate. I'm just going to jump in real quick because it's 11:56. So wondering if it's possible to wrap up in the next minute or two.
Okay. Let me skip a few things here.
Is it possible to let people leave if they want, but continue a little bit longer?
Yes, we will definitely keep going until at least 12:15 with questions, but I'm going to wrap up with just a few things I need to say before 12 o'clock too.
Okay, so I've got a poem I want you to... Oh, well, I guess we're going to have to skip the galls then. These galls are diagnostic for valley oaks.
Kate, you know what? Why don't I just go ahead and say a few things?
Yeah.
And then we can keep going with your presentation.
Good idea.
Is that all right?
Yeah, I love that.
And I just want everybody to know really quickly about how they can get in touch with us in the future and about our upcoming events. And then we'll get back to Kate. So I just wanted to mention this is the 9th in a series of about 20 virtual events that we have with the Center for Environmental Inquiry this fall. So I want everyone to be able to check those out at cei.sonoma.edu/calendar. Maybe Margot can put that in the chat for us. And there's just a couple that I want to point out. So in line with today's natural history focus, we have one coming up called Ticks on the Move on November 5th, and this is by UC Davis researcher Emily Pasco talking about her research on hosts and predators of these small but dangerous critters. Then in December, we have a rare opportunity called Photography with Assistive Technology, and that's for anyone with a disability or those interested in nature photography access for all, including for folks impacted by the ongoing fires or pandemic. Followed by the last one in our December event series is Winter Writing Walk, and that's the third event led by former SSU English professor Lakin Khan on how to use our senses in nature to articulate our experiences in writing. It's really a fun event. And then the last thing I want to call out is a series that we have this year for the first time called Live from the Field, in which researchers from biological field stations literally across the world all come together to discuss their research and how they got involved in their field on a specific topic. So these are really designed for undergraduate university students, ideally by instructors bringing their classes as part of curriculum, but anybody's welcome to attend. So do check out our website for details. Let me know if you're an instructor, because we have pre and post event educational materials prepared as well to make these really easy to incorporate into your classes. So thank you for putting that in the chat, Margot. And I do want to thank everybody for attending if you have to take off early. And I welcome everybody to stay and hear the rest of the presentation and ask questions. So go ahead, Kate, and go back to it.
Okay, it's not a lot longer. So another helpful word or concept when you are trying to identify oaks is lacy, because valley oaks tend to have a lacy look that none of the other trees have. It's because of all these deep, wide sinuses, which create a lot of negative space, or holes like lace has. And I especially see it on clusters of young leaves, which are also often, maybe it's just that I see them down near the bottom of the tree. But I can be driving along on a highway and see laciness and know that I'm looking at valley oaks. So if you've been trying to identify a tree and you're still scratching your head and you can't tell if it's a valley oak or an Oregon oak, look for these galls right here in this far left column. They both occur only on valley oak, and here they are magnified. This one is called the convoluted gall. I forget the common name of this one. You have to look really closely because this one is probably about half an inch wide at the most, and this one might be half an inch tall at the most. And their colors will vary with age a little bit. But and for me, it's like a treasure hunt. I love when I look around on valley oak leaves and find especially this gall on the right. You can read a pretty entertaining chapter in my book about the fascinating phenomenon that is galls. And I will also send you a web address, this web address right here for Joyce Gross, who has incredible gall photography on the internet. And we'll also send information about her new book, A Field Guide to California Insects, that just came out. She's a co-author and she did almost all of the photography. And if you look at one of these galls on her site, and you can click on the picture and that'll take you to a whole bunch more pictures and more information, like what tree she found it on and what its common name is and things like that. Your last tip for valley oaks is that their trunks and branches often form a vase shape. So here is our final, well, here's my poem about valley oaks. Okay. Majestic valley oaks, tallest of their kind, their super long nuts bring a V shape to mind. With round lobe leaves and the deepest of sinuses, V is for valley, say these royal highnesses. Want to say that with me? Majestic valley oaks, tallest of their kind, their super long nuts bring a V shape to mind. With round lobe leaves and the deepest of sinuses, V is for valley, say these royal highnesses. And here in Mendocino County, we have the tallest oak tree in the world, and it's a valley oak. I think it's about 158 feet. And then you can just glance at all those V words there. Okay, and by the way, this is the time to go out looking for galls. Most of the colorful, really cool galls occur in the fall, and they often get knocked off leaves when the rains come. So, if you have a chance to do that. And the trees that have the most galls on them are blue oaks. There are 41 different species of gall wasps that lay their eggs on blue oaks, and valley oaks are next. Now on to Oregon oak, also known as Gary oak, especially by scientists. But lots of people call this oak just white oak, and you can see why by the color of the trunk. But that's not diagnostic. Sometimes trunks look a lot darker because they have moss on them, or I don't know, they've gotten stained. So there, and it's good to use either the name Gary oak, Oregon oak, or Quercus garyana, the scientific name, because there are so many oaks in the white oak section, and it's just more clear about what you're talking about. The typical Oregon oak leaf has shallower and more diagonal sinuses than valley oak leaves do. So this is what I call a diagonal sinus, another diagonal sinus. I was going to say science. And they have these acute tipped lobes that aren't as softly rounded as those valley oak lobes. And to me, these sinuses seem more like fjords than valleys. So the mnemonic for valley oak is even more apt than I thought. So now I'm going to show you a couple of photos that you haven't seen yet and see if you can tell which is which. And you can see, I think, why these leaves get confusing to people, because to the untrained eye, they would just look like slight variations on the same leaf. So make your votes, and then I will give you the answers. Valley Oak on the top, Oregon, Gary Oak on the bottom. Diagonal scientists, acute tip sinuses, acute tip lobes, deep wide valleys, softly rounded lobes. And those little red galls there, those are a bonus. I do see them mostly on valley oak leaves. Sometimes they're just covered with them, though they can be found on other oaks in the white oak section. And I don't think anyone ever gets Oregon oak acorns confused with valley oaks. So Oregon oak, O-shaped acorn, and O-shaped gall. Oh, haven't showed you the gall yet. So there is a one gall right here that occurs only on Oregon oak. So this one is diagnostic. It's the speckled oak gall, I think it's called, and its walls are papery thin. It's kind of about the size of a ping pong ball. And now we finally get to blue oaks. I took this photo yesterday in hazy air. And ye shall know blue oaks by their barely lobed leaves. See how this one has hardly any lobes or any sinuses? And their bluish cast. So if you determine that your tree is in the white oak section, classic blue oak leaves are unmistakable because they have no lobes or minimal lobes. They also have a soft, velvety, or matte surface. So here is the mnemonic aid. Blue is for barely lobed leaves, bluish cast, and then another B word is a buttery, soft, matte surface. It's usually like that. That's not 100%. But people often mistake, you could look at this and think that maybe it was a interior live oak leaf, if you don't know. So a lot of people mistake them for live oak leaves in the red oak section because those are also unlobed. But compare this color to this color. Those upper ones are in the are from interior live oaks. They could also be from coast live oaks. Also, look how glossy those live oak leaves are compared to the matte finish of the blue oak leaves. The live oak leaves are also stiffer than the blue oak leaves, which are soft and flexible. And last but not least, we have the blue oak acorn, which, as you see, can be V-shaped like valley oak acorns, but they're not as long and the cup doesn't come up as high on the nut. So here we have three acorns that I photographed yesterday. And these are all the same age and they're in the similar stage of development. And these are much shorter than the valley oak acorn. So we'll go out with a blue oak poem. And why don't you just read it with me the first time. As summer goes on, blue's leaves become bluer, with surfaces matte and lobes absent to fewer. Acorns don't measure much more than an inch. With small warty caps, the ID's a cinch. Okay. If you're overwhelmed with too much information, I recommend that you start with just one oak, ideally an oak that has some of the classic characteristics that I've shown you, and figure out the section first, and then see if you can figure out the species. Look at leaves a lot, and I didn't even talk about bark and structure much today, but you can learn that on your own. You can figure that out after you figure out what species you have. And have faith that a time will come when you will be walking along, looking at the ground. Maybe you'll be looking for tarantula burrows or or you'll be looking at ant mounds, or you'll be looking for animal scat, and you will know without looking up and without even thinking about it what species of oak you're walking under. That's what's happened for me. You will also, once you get to know your oaks, you will also have interesting, endlessly interesting companions all over the state and even all over the northern hemisphere. And don't forget to go out looking for galls. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Kate, for staying this late. And 178 people wanted to stay on with us. So that just shows you. So there were actually quite a few questions that came in while you were presenting. So I think if it's okay, I'll go ahead and start asking some of those. And everyone else, you can feel free and type in more questions you have right now. So.
Well, we'll see if I have the answers.
Yeah, let's just see. Okay, so first off, Sabrina says, Sonoma County recently removed recently fallen old oak from the Pollen Creek open space, technically Parcel J, the county property within Santa Rosa's city limits. I was so sad. As I understood from your secrets of oak woodlands, how many animals would make good use of that fallen oak for years to come? How do we put you in touch with someone from the county to help them understand the benefit of leaving fallen trees in place?
Well, you could send me an email or if you could do the research to find out who I would have to talk to in the county, I would be happy to make the connection. My email address is katem@mcn.org. So just shoot that over to me and I'll see what I can do. I don't know that they'll listen to me, and I also think there are probably plenty of people in Sonoma County who know just as well as you and I do how important those the dead trees are for not just habitat, but also returning their nutrients to the soil. And sometimes I don't know if the roots came out or not, but sometimes they even are kept alive by neighboring trees, but through the mycorrhizal fungi.
Kate, really quickly, can you repeat that email address? Is it MCN or MCM?
Oh yeah, M, Mary Carol Nancy,
MCN. MCN, okay.
Yeah.
Great, next question. Where can I get a copy of the two-sided oak page that you showed?
Okay, you can go to my website, which is Kate Marianchild, MARIANCHILD, all one word, .com, www.katemarianchild.com. And as I said earlier, I'm not very techie and I haven't been able to modify my homepage as I've added things to my website. So you can't find that guide on my homepage. But if you click on any other page, if you click on my book page or my binocular page or my contact page or any other page, you can see a menu on the left and the oak guide is listed there. Now, I have a setup now that you have to order three. If you order any, you have to order three. That's just because I didn't want to spend a lot of time shipping individual guides. And they're great gifts, and they're also great just for educating the general population about oaks, which is important for their ongoing preservation. But if you really only want one, go ahead and order three, and I will refund you the difference. I can do it automatically through PayPal.
Great. Next question. Elaine Gehrman asks, which oak's acorns were most used for human consumption, Native Americans? And another person, Gay Henry, actually wrote, there's a YouTube, California Naturalist, California Native History, Land Use and Traditional Ecological Knowledge, which is an interview with two Pomo women who say their favorite acorns are the ones they grew up with, not just black or tan oak. So I thought those comments were connected.
Oh, great. Okay. I didn't know that.
Any more about that to add?
Just that my Pomo friends prefer tan oak and black oak acorns. But I have heard about, another Pomo friend of mine I grew up eating white oak acorns. So I don't know if it was blue or more valley.
Interesting. All right. So somebody else wanted to comment. So Lindsay Joyce says, I say there's gold in them canyons to remember gold hairs under canyon oaks.
Oh, that's great. Thank you.
He also says coast live oak leaves are often curved like a wave by the coast.
Right. I didn't talk about the leaves. I just gave that one. Well, I talked about the veins and I couldn't fit in everything I wanted to. but they're often not curved too. On my guide, you'll see a flat one and a curved one.
And I personally like to say that they're like little boats on the coast.
Oh, that's great.
Like if you actually put them in a puddle of water, they would float as a little. Marlon Harms has another comment. I'm questioning the idea of oak apple galls only in the white section. Coast live oak in red section makes them, though initiated by a different insect. Any comments?
Yes, I've seen those, and they look like the galls we call oak apple galls, which is, I forget, this Quercus californicus, I think. But those, so each gall that, each different, let's see, galls that look different from each other are all induced by a different species of wasp. So those galls on on interior live oaks is where I've seen them that look very similar. They're actually, you can see differences in them. They look very similar, but they're induced by a different wasp, and the wasp that induced that one would not jump sections and would not induce one on a white oak and vice versa.
And yeah.
Go ahead.
I personally know also flies can make galls. Is that something?
Yes.
Like oaks?
Flies can make galls, midges, mites. But what I've been talking about today is the cynipid galls that induce, the cynipid wasps that induce galls on oaks.
Got it.
So I don't know about section jumping in mites or midges or any other kind of insect.
And you know, we actually have a Prahlada Popper on this event right now. And he says there's often a difference between what you prefer to eat and what you actually eat the most in comment to the previous comment, I believe.
Oh, Thank you.
All right, next up. Belinda Gilbert asks, do scrub jays eat the acorn or insects in the acorn?
They eat the acorn, and they actually prefer white oak acorns, probably because they have less tannin. But I think that question was probably inspired by a 100-year-old myth that acorn woodpeckers don't store acorns for the acorns themselves, but for the insects that invade the acorns. And that is, I shouldn't have used the word myth, but that is not true. It is a idea that got started probably 120 years ago, and it has never died. But wow. Acorn woodpeckers do eat acorns.
I've heard that too.
Yeah, when Walt Koenig, who's the world authority on acorn woodpeckers, gives talks, he has his whole audience chant after him, acorn woodpeckers eat acorns. But while we're on that subject, acorn woodpeckers, actually their preferred food is aerial flying insects, especially flying ants. So acorns are their backup food, but a very important backup food. They would starve most winters if they didn't have their acorn granaries.
Wow.
Well, I got off on a tangent there, sorry.
No, that's, I'm sure people are very interested in that answer. a simple question, or maybe it's a comment. Valerie says, coast live oak leaves are always cupped. Yes, we already covered that.
But they're not always.
Ah, the good point. And then Suzanne Pletcher, where is the tallest oak? It says in the world in Mendocino County. So I'm not sure exactly if she's
it's in Covelo. as you're driving into Covelo on 162, it's after you get down onto the floodplain, it's on the right. It's on an old Fetzer property.
Is that public knowledge?
Yeah.
Not getting the inside scoop.
No.
And then there's a couple questions about that kind of go together. So Carol and Clover ask, what makes a white oak white, a red oak red, a golden oak golden? Why the color differentiation? Not obvious to me.
Okay, but they're just kind of superficial reasons. The trunks of white oaks often look white or gray-white. The wood of red oaks is often red. And the golden oak is called that because of the golden fuzz or hair, little fine hairs that cover the acorns and the backs of the leaves.
And a few more questions along that line. Do the blue oaks fall into the white oak section? Why the different sections for the oaks and how do they apply?
Oh, so that's a thing I forgot to mention. I said that black oak, it's confusing because the black oak is in the red oak section, and I usually say, and the blue oak is in the white oak section. And sections are a taxonomic category based on DNA, and they are important because oaks can only interbreed within their section. So white oaks can't breed, the pollen of a white oak can't successfully pollinate the flowers of a red oak or a golden oak and vice versa.
And that leads perfectly into this question from Jill. I have a tree with valley oak acorns, but black oakish leaves that have spines and are pinkish when they emerge. Do those two hybridize?
No. So if they have those bristle tips, those long flexible spine, like hair-like things on the end of the leaves, you might think it's a valley oak because the leaves have deep lobes, but valley oak leaves will never have bristle tips. And the only oak that has bristle tips is the black oak. And none of the oaks in the white oak group, Valley, Oregon, Blue, none of the deciduous oaks in the white oak group, Valley, Oregon, and Blue, for instance, Engelmann is in the south, have spiny tips at the end of their lobes, except occasionally blue oaks do. There are always exceptions. So if you have any kind of a pointed tip that's a little bit hard or, you know, sort of, you know, what would be keratinous or something, you don't have a valley oak.
Another question that is separate here. We are in a fire area, says Jan, Sonoma County, and they want us to limb our trees up 5 feet off the ground. Does this hurt the tree in any way?
I'm not an expert on that at all. I don't think I should address that.
Another question that's related, Janet asks, are there acorns we should collect to help replant after the fires?
Well, all acorns, it's the more planting you can do to help the scrub jays after the fires, the better. So the thing is, keep track of where your acorn came from and not just the actual type of terrain, but the altitude. It's good to plant acorns at similar altitudes to where the tree lived that produced them.
And I know that the California Native Plant Society last year, or was it the year before, was working on an acorn, like a replanting effort, and they had instructions and guides for how to be really specific in where you plant what. So that might be a resource to look into.
Yeah.
Okay, another question. Now we're back to galls again.
Okay.
Do you have Gary and Valley oaks have large round galls. I have oak samples with the small galls as well as a large attached round gall.
I have oak samples with,
I have oak samples with the small galls as well as a large attached round gall.
Okay, well, Oregon oak and Valley oak are in the same section. So a lot of the same wasps, the same wasps will lay their eggs on both of them, except for a couple of species of wasps. So yes, both of them can have the big round oak apple galls that look kind of like baked potatoes when they're brown and look kind of like green apples when they're green. But each of those species also has, you can find a whole lot of other kinds of smaller galls on both of those species. The oak apple galls are the largest galls in the West, but most of the galls are smaller.
And a few more questions on galls. Are gall wasps considered beneficial?
That's a really good question. Nobody really knows for sure whether they harm the trees that they appear on. But there are trees that have so many galls on them that from a distance, oak trees, that from a distance it looks like they're covered with pink flowers. That has happened. And it seems, and when I look at valley oaks that are especially kind of young, scrawny valley oaks that are totally covered with galls, I can't help but think that the galls are taking a toll on them. Mm-hmm. But they have co-evolved with galls, and I don't think it's our problem. I think it's a fine natural phenomenon, and that we shouldn't do we can't really do anything about it anyway. And we're in this situation now where that's been called an insect apocalypse, although it's unclear. It might not be as serious here in this country as it is in Europe, but it's certainly a huge issue in this country. And as far as I'm concerned, all insects are beneficial because they become food for other members of the food web.
Well, very apropos. So first off, two people were responding to the previous question. Andy says the blue oak gall might be a similar wasp, and then similar wasp as the valley.
I've never heard of a gall called the blue oak gall.
Or the blue oak gall might be a similar wasp as for the valley oak, I think was the idea.
I don't think there is a gall called the blue oak gall, and there are 41 wasps that lay eggs on blue oaks, and each one induces a different kind of gall. Mm. And many of them also induce galls on valley oaks. Mm-hmm. And I wonder if everybody in the audience knows about the gall phenomenon, how it is that galls come to be on oaks. You know, that it's just so amazing that the tree responds to chemical commands from a tiny, tiny wasp and provides the wasp with a full service daycare center complete with food for its larvae to molt in and pupate in. There's more about that in my book.
Alyssa wanted to clarify that when she asked if the gall wasps were beneficial, she meant, do they eat insects that are potentially harmful to the plant?
Oh, that's what beneficial tends to mean. They're tiny. I doubt that they have much effect in that way because they're so tiny themselves.
Got it. And you know, it's interesting what you were mentioning about humans and how we might come into play with this system, because Karen writes, in Hawaii, I did see there's someone from Hawaii, in Hawaii, Waikoloa dry forest is introducing a wasp that preys upon the gall wasps on the willy willy tree. Interesting.
Huh.
So they think I
wonder if the gall wasp on the willy willy tree are native. Maybe they're not. Otherwise, I wouldn't mess with it myself.
Interesting, though. And Sabrina asks, is there a typical time of year the mature insects emerge from the galls?
Well, there are two generations of gall wasps. And there's a spring generation and a fall generation. And the spring generation is known to be, this isn't answering the question, but it's interesting. They reproduce sexually, and the fall generation in many species usually reproduces parthenogenically without benefit of fertilization by a male. And I see exit holes in galls now, like those two big oak apple galls that I showed you in the slide. They did have some exit holes in them, and I think they were this year's galls. So probably those adults emerge this fall or summer, summer or fall, but I'm not positive about that. And I know that sometimes they can, with that gall in particular, they can stay in the gall for up to 2 years, I think.
Wow.
So that's something I haven't studied, though, is the time of emergence.
You know, we have two people that help us out with the Hawaii question. So Joe says Hawaii is full of non-native species.
Yeah.
Grouch says the gall in Hawaii wasps is non-native and have devastated the willy-willy population.
Oh, okay.
So good to know. And, you know, I remember somebody typed this, but I can't remember who it was. They wanted to know if only female trees produce acorns.
Oak trees are what's called monoecious, meaning mon means one, and oecious means house. So one house means that male and female flowers appear on the same plant. So, and the pollen of one that's produced by the catkins, the male catkins of one tree, will disperse earlier than the female flowers of that tree are ready to receive pollen, so that it won't pollinate the same tree. So the pollen will be carried by the wind to a neighboring tree whose female flowers might be ready.
Mm-hmm. I wanted to get a couple people here who commented about the re-oaking efforts with some information that people might want to see the chat for. So Sue says, the California Native Plant Society started a project called Re-Oak California to collect and plant acorns after the 2017 North Bay fires. I don't know whether the project is still active, but you can learn more at this link. And it's a link in the chat there at cnps.org. And then Francis says, Napa Resource Conservation District is collecting Napa acorns this year for planting projects, and you can contact ashley@naparcd.org.
Fantastic.
More questions. Pam asks, what causes a mast year? And Robert Hall asks, are we in a mast year?
Masting is a very complex phenomenon, and it's not well understood yet. And I don't think I should comment on it, but from my observation, and you know, some years it's a mast year for one species. The oak species usually aren't synchronized with each other. I mean, the blue oaks won't produce a whole lot of acorns in the same year that the valley oaks do, in the same year that the red oaks do. It's seems to be kind of individual by species. And I'm seeing more blue oak acorns this year than I've seen in a long time. But otherwise, I'm not seeing signs of it being a super mast year in general for acorns. I'd be interested in hearing what anybody else wants to say on that if they want to submit a chat, because it varies by elevation and somewhat by habitat.
Someone has a follow-up question. Brenda asks, are you saying that a valley oak is both male and female? We have an oak in Sonoma, which is very old and called the grandmother oak. Can you comment on this name, please, as I have a Sonoma Nature Journal group?
Oh, yeah. All trees are both male and female. people just, I mean, all oak trees. So people just tend to call ancient trees grandmothers more than grandfathers for some reason, but it's it doesn't mean anything about the tree's actual gender.
Pam also wanted to remark about masting. She said last year was heavy. It was an extremely heavy acorn drop for live oaks in Ukiah.
Yes, I had that. I noticed that too.
And then I'm not quite sure what this is in reference to, but West Nine Slope, I don't know your real name, if you want to make sure you've entered that so I can make sure you attended today, says elevation 1500 foothills near Auburn. So that might have to do with the re-oaking when you said elevation is important to consider. I'm not sure if that is what they meant by that comment.
Yeah, I don't know either.
And that person just wrote Bill, light blue oak drop this year.
Oh, it's a light drop.
Oak drop this year. Yeah.
I wonder how many of you have seen early drops. I've seen a lot of green acorns that I don't think I've seen this many green acorns drop this early in years past.
It's interesting because Margaret now says that my blue oak had lots of acorns this year, but when I went out to collect yesterday, it seems like the sentence got cut off, but maybe not so much yesterday.
Huh. I wonder if the birds got them or something.
All right, couple more questions. I've been seeing some very dark, almost black acorns on the ground lately among brown acorns. What makes them so dark?
It's just how they age. I see it mostly with Oregon oak acorns and Oregon oaks, blue oaks, and canyon live oak. I think it's, I think those are the three that I see that the most with. And I don't know what causes them to turn black. I think it's beautiful though.
Shelley Spriggs comments or asks, is it common for the first drop to have weevils?
Well, I have most of the ones that I've seen in the first drop have had weevils, and that could be part of why they're getting dropped. Maybe, I don't know if the tree aborts them or not. I've been wondering that.
Lynn says in Potter Valley, the blue oaks have produced plenty of early acorns. Almost none are under our interior live oaks and black oaks.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Joanne Whitney wants to know what oaks might do best in San Francisco.
Well, coast live oak, and I would think maybe interior live. I'm not sure about that. Coast live oak for sure. And in valleys, maybe valley oak.
And then Marge wants us to know that in Orangevale, which is near Folsom, my blue oaks dropped a lot very early, starting in August this year.
Yeah, see, that's what I've noticed too. I don't think I've seen that before.
Now here's a question. How do the oaks stand with sudden oak death, asks Mila. I laugh because I also work with UC Cooperative Extension as their sudden oak death outreach coordinator. So I get a lot of these questions.
Can you answer that one? I'm not an expert on sudden oak death at all.
Oh, well, it's just such a general question. So there was new research that came out recently showing just how many oaks have been killed and are likely to be killed, and it's in the hundreds of millions. So it is a severe problem, and it's something I think everyone should consider taking care of. But it's always really important for folks to know that not all oaks are affected. There's only 5 species that actually die, including tan oak, right, which isn't a true oak. So it's only going to be your red oaks. So your white oaks cannot catch sudden oak death. So there's way more to be said, but that's the basics. Mm-hmm. And I'm happy to answer more questions personally and professionally if you want to contact me about anything sudden oak death related. All right, more questions. What does a crinkly surfaced acorn indicate? Also, what does a rattling sound in an acorn indicate?
Well, the crinkly surface, if it's kind of like furrowed, if that's what you mean by crinkly, it just means that it's drying out. And if there's a rattling sound, it means that it's no longer fertile, or it's probably had insect damage that caused the nut to shrivel up and shrink, and that's why it's rattling, making that noise. So when you're considering planting an acorn, shake it to see if you hear that rattling noise. And that's what scrub jays do too. They heft it, they see how heavy it is, and they wave it around to see if it's rattling.
Nancy says, I have an oak leaf sample with leaves that look clearly valley oak and leaves that look like Oregon oak. The acorns are only slightly longer than wide. Can those two oaks cross-pollinate?
Oh, yes. That's the big, huge problem with valley oaks and Oregon oaks. Valley oaks and blue oaks and Oregon oaks. The genes flow freely between them, and they end up looking like a little bit of other species. So that's... So if you really want to figure out which one it is, you could look for one of the galls that only occurs on valley oak. There are two galls that only occur on valley oak. There's one gall that only occurs on Oregon oak, and they're both on my chart, on my oak guide. But the acorn, I don't know if it's right now, the acorns are still green, so you'll have to look and see. But if the acorns are pointy rather than roundy, I would suspect it's more valley oak than Oregon oak, but it's probably a little bit of both.
And even though this was the most recently asked question, it's appropriate here. Frederick asks, do oaks only hybridize within sections?
Yes.
And then Lynn asks, do hybridized oaks have fertile acorns?
Yes.
All right. Now another one. Mila asks, when collecting acorns for revegetation, how do you know which ones are viable?
Well, you look at the outside and you see if you see dark spots or holes, and that means they're not viable. Or you shake them and see if they rattle. And in that case, they're not viable.
So Marge asks, when collecting acorns for replanting, is it better to collect acorns that are purple or brown, or are green ones okay too?
They should be brown. They should have fully matured. I noticed that acorn woodpeckers harvest and store green acorns. It's fine for them to eat them, but they aren't viable for planting.
And then Mila wanted to comment about the question regarding San Francisco. We have an orchard every spring from acorns that are left in caches. Coast live oak is the native tree in San Francisco. All right, Dee Roble asks, how long does it take an oak tree to produce acorns? How old does the tree have to be?
They usually don't start producing acorns until they're 20 or 30 years old.
Wow. A note on viability from Seth Kaupinen. You can also do the float test. Drop them in a bucket of water.
Thank you.
If they float, they're not viable.
I forgot that. Thank you.
And actually, another person, Michela, wrote, I've heard that you can drop acorns into water. If they float, they're not viable. Is this true? So that was submitted at the same time.
Great. Thank you.
Well, believe it or not, that's the last question now that we've been 44 minutes over time. So if anyone has any other questions, now is the time. It's your last call. But other than that, golly, I just can't say thank you enough to Kate for staying this long and just such an engaging conversation from everybody. Oh, Sabrina says one more question and she's going to type it. While she's typing, I just want you to know, Kate, there are so many thank yous and this is wonderful and very informative, all sorts of wonderful comments here. So people are truly appreciating this. Okay, a question. How diagnostic of species is pink early leaf?
It's usually black oak. They leap out the earliest, and their leaves are pink. There are some different theories about that. One is that the pinkness or redness protects the leaves against sunburn. And the other idea is that it might fake out caterpillars, I think it is. It might fake out anybody that might want to consume the leaves and disguise those juicy, those fresh, delicious leaves from anybody who might want to eat them.
All right. So I have Alyssa encouraging us to visit the oaks at UC Davis if we can. Was happy about hearing a hummingbird in my backyard, so I'm glad you all can hear that. And then Sabrina has her question. I've noticed a lot of small, tiny, round bits, like some kind of insect excrement, on the deck under our four coast live oaks. Any idea who's producing it?
Well, under coast live oaks, it might be the California oak worm, which eats the leaves of the coast live oak and has kind of a co-evolutionary mutualist relationship with coast live oak. Sometimes they'll completely defoliate a tree, but the trees survive, and it's thought that the insects are attracting birds, which then also poop under the tree and add fertilizer, and the insects themselves contribute fertilizer to the tree. So that's my best guess, but I don't know when those caterpillars are active, and so I don't. If it's right now, it seems kind of late. It seems like a strange time for that.
You know, it's interesting. My graduate research was about insects on bay trees, which are closely associated with coast live oaks. If you have any bay trees next to those coast live oaks, Sabrina, let me know, because I might have some other options for what that might be. Mila.
Can I just say something, though? What I thought the question was going to be about was tiny little, what they are is galls that are about the size of quinoa grains, and they come out of, they fall off of valley oak leaves, and they have little larvae inside them that start flipping to try to get the gall into a crevice someplace where it'll be hidden from predators. And so they jump around kind of like Mexican jumping beans. And I wonder if anybody here has ever seen that. So they often collect, and if there are enough of them, and if they're falling on asphalt or pavement, it can actually sound like falling rain.
Wow. Sabrina does clarify that these are teeny, like pebbles of sand, hard and dry, in recent weeks. And there's been plenty of bird activity, like there always has been. There are no bay trees nearby, and they're smaller than quinoa.
And they're hard, because I mean that the size sounds a lot like the size of the caterpillar poop that I find under trees in the spring, like under blue oaks and valley oaks, I'm not sure what she's talking about.
Well, other people have heard and seen the galls you're talking about. So Ashley says we have them here in Napa County, and they're so cool. Mm-hmm. Sabrina says they're super interesting, though. The teeny galls contain tiny larvae. As Sabrina, they are abundant, like rain. Thank you. And then we did have one more question. Mila asks, what percentage of acorns are forgotten by squirrels and birds?
Well, it's about 30%. About 30% of acorns are forgotten or just not needed by California scrub jays. And squirrels do plant acorns, but they aren't, the acorns they plant aren't very significant in the overall planting of oaks in California, because squirrels don't move very far from the tree. And I have no idea how many they forget, but I don't think that scrub jays, did I say acorn woodpeckers earlier? I don't think scrub jays forget the acorns they plant. They have incredible memories, and they can remember the locations of acorns that they have buried in unmarked locations for up to 250 days. So I think when they don't come back, and they plant up to 5,000 acorns a year. So when they don't come back for acorns, I think it's just that they don't need them, not that they've forgotten them. But if the question is how many get left in the ground, with that species, it's up to 30%. And scrub jays are the primary planter of California's acorns by an order of magnitude. There are other birds that do plant acorns, like magpies and stellar jays, but their numbers just don't compare with scrub jay numbers.
Sabrina says that she's discovered an Oregon oak sapling growing in her front yard, but there's not an Oregon oak within sight from her house, possibly one 0.2 mile away in the open space, maybe planted by a jay?
Absolutely, yeah. They travel long. That's the other thing about scrub jays as planters. Like, squirrels will not take an acorn very far from the mother tree, and but scrub jays take them, I don't know how far, I can't remember, but long distances.
Wow. Well, I love that we had a last call for questions and got like five more, but now we actually are done.
Okay.
So for everyone still here, which there are over almost 80 of us still, thank you so much for attending. I know I learned a ton. I have my little paper here. I thought I had a white oak, and now I realized it's actually a golden oak. So I'm really excited to have learned today. And I just want to encourage everyone to email me or Kate, go to her website, or Margot, who initially set this event up but was unable to lead it today. So any one of us can answer your questions. And if you feel like you have some expertise that you want to share, we're always looking for virtual event leaders. So feel free and talk to us about that as well. And I also just want to make sure everyone realizes virtual events can be attended from everywhere. So literally today, we had people from up in the Sacramento area, Mendocino, Marin, Sonoma, Hawaii. My dad joins these from Maryland sometimes. So feel free and spread the word.
Armel.
Yeah, so everyone can enjoy and learn. And thank you one last time, Kate Marianchild. We are incredibly grateful. And I'm going to say goodbye. Hope you all can get out into nature soon. And we will see you later.